Available at brownpapertickets.com or supportive independent bookstores. Treat your inner self. Hear Alice Walker with Nina Serrano, October 18th.
KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org.
And the time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for Project Censored.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show. I am your host, Mickey Huff, in studio with Chase Palmieri. On today's program, for the hour, we highlight Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion. We'll spend the hour talking about Project Censored's latest annual release from Seven Stories Press, Censored 2019. We'll be joined by Associate Director and my co-editor, Andy Lee Roth, as well as Professor Steve Masick and Eleanor Goldfield. An hour with Project Censored. Stay with us.
Thinkable crimes perpetrated by criminal minds, political ties, habitualized alibis, skies, another guy's democracy, politics, the apocalypse, got the skies like an ominous.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. On today's program, we dedicate the hour to the Project Censored annual book release. The annual book, Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion, Top Censored Stories and Media Analysis of 2017 and 18, is out from Seven Stories Press, and you can get a copy at your independent bookstore or at projectcensored.org. Did you know that since 1998, the U.S. government spent $21 trillion that it can't account for? Or that internet co-ops are mobilizing poor communities to resist net neutrality rollbacks? How about the health risks of wireless tech that cell phone companies have covered up? Or the opiate crisis that Big Pharma knowingly unleashed? Haven't heard the news? Neither did the rest of the world. That's because these and countless other news items are suppressed or ignored by our nation's so-called free press every day. For the past 43 years, Project Censored has been unearthing the buried stories that corporate media deem unfit to print, and debunking the fake news governments and corporations use to consolidate their power to promote well-informed citizen action and critical media literacy. Of course, this year's book houses the top 25. It also has the return of junk food news and news abuse, media democracy in action. And of course, we also have some support, some wonderful blurbs on the 2019 book. Peter Kuznick and Oliver Stone, The Untold History of the United States, say of Censored 2019, "If journalism is the rough draft of history, this book goes a long way to getting the record right the first time, stopping fake news in its tracks." Well, for the hour today, we'll be talking about Censored 2019, and I am the co-editor with Dr. Andy Lee Roth. This is actually my 10th Censored book with Seven Stories Press. It's my 7th with Andy Lee Roth, and I'm going to tell you a couple things here about Andy. You can learn more at projectcensored.org. Andy Roth is the associate director of Project Censored. He's the co-editor of 8 previous editions of the Censored Yearbook. He coordinates Project's validated independent news program. His research on topics ranging from ritual to broadcast news interviews to communities organizing for parklands has been published in such journals as the International Journal of Press and Politics, Social Studies of Science, Media, Culture and Society, City and Community, and Sociological Theory. Andy Lee Roth earned his PhD in sociology from the University of California, Los Angeles. He has a BA in sociology and anthropology from Haverford College, and he has taught courses in sociology at Citrus College, Pomona College in Southern California, Sonoma State University, and the College of Marin, and Bard College. Andy Lee Roth now lives in Seattle. So for the first part of our program today, we will be in discussion with Andy Lee Roth. Andy Lee Roth, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Thanks so much, Mickey. It's a pleasure to join you and Chase.
And every year, of course, at the Project Censored Show, we highlight our annual production. The book, right, Censored this year is Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion, and just talked a little bit about what's in the book here in our introduction. before I introduced you, Andy. So let's just jump right in. There's a striking cover on the book this year. And of course, listeners can go to projectcensored.org to see the really eye-popping work of this year's cover. And it was done by Anson Stevens Bolin. And we have an artist statement in the book. So Andy, why don't we just start right from the cover? Can you talk about what are we riffing on here in the book this year?
Well, the cover depicts a kind of Anson's vision of an updated version of H.G. Wells' classic science fiction story, The War of the Worlds. So Anson has brought that imagery of a Martian invasion of Earth forward to the 21st century, reimagining the extraterrestrial spaceships as kind of half-human, half-mechanized soldiers, and spouting from the backs of these several hundred-foot-tall, half-human, half-machine creatures is just billowing clouds of choking smoke, and the landscape that they're moving through is one of devastation. So it's a fairly bleak cover to introduce the theme of this year's book is fighting the fake news invasion. So it's a bleak context, but as the book works very hard to do and as a number of our contributors make fantastic inroads on, we're finding ways to approach this bleak situation from a positive perspective.
Indeed, and that's showcased right out of the gate with a foreword by Abby Martin of the Empire Files. And Abby frames the post-truth dilemma, as it were, the title of her foreword. And then, of course, you and I jump into the introduction, riffing again on the cover. We start by talking about the black smoke of fake news. So let's tie some of those concepts in to the riffs you mentioned with H.G. Wells.
First, to talk a little bit about fake news and the idea of fighting fake news. One of the things that we talk about is two types of countermeasures that prove effective in fighting fake news. The first of those is a very direct approach. The first countermeasure is to simply expose specific instances of misinformation or disinformation when they occur, right? So this involves classic critical thinking and media literacy skills like identifying and fact-checking dubious claims to truth. It involves the tasks of holding journalists and news outlets to account when they produce reports that are false or misleading. And this is exactly what Project Censored has been doing for decades now. So that's one component of fighting the fake news invasion, right? Exposing specific instances of misinformation and disinformation. The other aspect of this where we think there's a lot of positive traction to be gained, the second kind of countermeasure, is to identify and counter the larger social and cultural factors that make fake news possible and persuasive in the first place. And so to kind of flesh that out, the idea is that if you think of the first countermeasure as focused on the contents of fake news, this second countermeasure, the idea of identifying the larger social and cultural factors, is in some sense focused on the idea of the context in which fake news is produced and reproduced. So we need to be able to think critically about how things are categorized or labeled in the first place as fake news or as misinformation and the politics of those practices of classification. So that's a second domain in which I think this year's book and indeed the history of the project and its goals as a whole, right, we are all about trying to put things in context so that there is a deeper understanding. Oftentimes the corporate coverage that a story gets doesn't go beneath the surface. It leaves us with a superficial understanding of what's happening.
You have some excellent further riffs that go on in the introductory material. What I was alluding to earlier was the so-called black smoke of fake news, which both alludes to the cover, but also to H.G. Wells' 1898 novel, as well as the 1938 War of the Worlds program, the broadcast by CBS Radio.
Yeah, this was something I started looking into in the spring when you and I were first talking to Anson Stevens Bolin about the cover art for the book, and quickly realized that next month will be the 80th anniversary of this kind of infamous radio broadcast of the War of the Worlds. So I'll say more about that in a moment, but the radio broadcast was itself based on, as we've mentioned, this 1898 science fiction classic, H.G. Wells' original War of the Worlds. And the more I dug into these stories and the kind of the history of them and the misunderstood legacy of these stories, the more fascinated I became. So just a few tidbits from what I found digging back in time this spring. So War of the Worlds, many of us know as the story of an invasion of Earth by Martians so much more technologically sophisticated than humans. That part of the H.G. Wells classic, I think, is known to a lot of people, and the imagery of the tentacled Martian invaders is familiar from artwork dating back to the original novel. But as I dug into it and reread that story, it's really quite amazing how much H.G. Wells saw back in 1898 that's relevant to our time. The story of War of the Worlds is really a story of imperialism and colonization, and it's also a story of ecological disaster. Now, when you say ecological disaster to most people thinking about War of the Worlds, they think, well, the destruction of Earth by the Martian invaders. But H.G. Wells is a fantastic storyteller, and one of the things he does, tucked away early in the novel, is a little aside by the story's narrator about how the reason the Martians have come to Earth is because they've ruined their own planet. The narrator talks about how Mars now suffers from an attenuated supply of air, its huge polar snow caps are melting, and the planet is in its last stages of exhaustion, according to the narrator's account. And this sounds remarkably like the times we live in today. And Wells is a master storyteller, and I think we remember his stories today, Around the World in 80 Days, War of the Worlds, and other of his classics, because he was able to describe in these allegorical, metaphorical science fiction terms things that we ourselves know about in the world. Right? And so the narrator warns us. He says, before we judge the Martians, the invading Martians, too harshly, we have to remember what ruthless and utter destruction our own species has wrought. So these themes of one people colonizing another, these themes of imperialism, these themes of ecological devastation as both a consequence of actions but also a motivator for destructive actions are all there in H.G. Wells' original novel.
Historically, in bringing up the present, again, you know, what you were just describing is what we're seemingly facing down. And of course, the stories in Censored 2019 go much further in detail in terms of outlining some of the challenges and crises we face, but of course, also highlighting many of the things that are being done to counter those. And of course, that's under the guise of fighting the fake news invasion. There's also fights to be had against what's happening in terms of the climate crisis. And we talk about that in some of the stories, the erosion of human rights as well. So we can get into more of those details here later on in our conversation. But Andy, the War of the Worlds broadcast is also an historic moment where we had hoax news or fake news, as it were, of the day. But that story kind of takes on a life of its own, and you went and dug up a more analytical and fact-based history of what was actually behind the phenomenon and its consequences. Could you remind our listeners a little bit about that and how it riffs along with our title?
The 1938 radio broadcast that we're coming up to this October anniversary of, it may be the most infamous radio broadcast in U.S. history. It's become legendary because the broadcast, this fictional presentation of the War of the Worlds story adapted for radio by the great Orson Welles, is legendary for having allegedly led to a widespread panic across the United States. So, for example, 2013 documentary broadcast by PBS on its American Experience program began by characterizing the War of the Worlds broadcast. Never before had a radio broadcast provoked such outrage or such chaos. And that narrative reflected kind of decades of popular understanding about the broadcast's enduring significance as kind of a cautionary tale of the mighty power of the media and the great vulnerability of the public to broadcast-induced hysteria. And as I dug into this, there's just fascinating interwoven threads and themes that continue in relevance 80 years on. But the most important thing, I think, to know about that broadcast is that the popular interpretation of it as having provoked mass hysteria is simply at odds with the facts. The real story behind the World of Worlds broadcast is actually more complex than the popular version of it that we have. But in simple terms, the reports of the audience size were significantly exaggerated, as were the accounts of hysteria. And as I read more about this, this is so timely to the period that we live in now and the challenges we're facing right now. So the story of the War of the Worlds broadcast in 1938, the official kind of popular understanding was people freaked out because they heard the account, which was intended to sound realistic, and they thought that there was an actual Martian invasion going on. The first thing to say about that is the broadcast was designed to elicit that reaction. Orson Welles, a master storyteller himself, used all kinds of features to make the broadcast itself seem like a real event. So they used real place names. There were repeated interruptions of supposedly regular programming for breaking news bulletins that grew increasingly serious and dramatic as the evening's program went on. And maybe the highlight, if you will, of the efforts to convey a sense of realism to the broadcast's audience was a moment where the narrator, who people listening to the broadcast had been led to believe is an eyewitness to the Martian invasion, the narrator is describing how a group of police are approaching a Martian ship when the Martian ship lashes out with a jet of flame. And the broadcast, under Orson Welles' directorial guidance, goes silent for 6 seconds, which doesn't sound like much time, but if we were to be quiet now for 6 seconds, it would sound like an eternity. As one scholarly study of the famous broadcast noted, during that time, anyone who was listening believed that they had heard the narrator and dozens of others burned to death by a Martian spaceship live on the air. So there were all kinds of features of the broadcast that were designed to make it sound realistic. And that's, I think, partly where we get this legend that the broadcast led to widespread panic. But as I say, a reassessment of the facts shows that that count, enticing and titillating as it may be, is simply at odds with what happened. First, the audience for the actual broadcast was not as great as people have claimed. And second, the effects of the broadcast on the people who did hear it were not as great because people used their critical thinking skills to check up on whether the broadcast was authentic or not. In other words, whether this was an actual report of a real extraterrestrial invasion.
It sounds pretty familiar to the things that we've been saying at Project Censored for some time, and that's the antidote to fake news or fighting fake news begins with critical thinking.
Right. If we imagine kind of the black smoke of fake news as now a metaphor for some of the challenges we face today, then the antidote to it is a lesson from the research that was actually conducted on the 1938 broadcast, when in the face of a spectacular story that was intended by all accounts to sound as if it were true, as if it were real, people used their critical skills. And this is, remember, this is in an age before the internet. They couldn't simply Google it to see if it was so or not. They had to use whatever resources they had available to them in their homes to check out, could this be true?
In fact, Andy Roth, you write about this in the intro. You actually write about how the newspaper industry had a stake in this as a rival media format.
Yeah. So the situation then was that the 1938 broadcast took place at a time when radio was a newly developing medium, but it was already beginning to compete successfully with print, for instance, newspapers and magazines, for audience attention and then critically for advertising revenues. And so, yeah, we have a very similar situation today when you think about it. You know, fake news, who spreads fake news as we understand it? There are all kinds of answers to that question, but almost all of them hinge around social media and platforms like Facebook or, you know, they aren't considered to be news providers, but the big, you know, digital media giants,
right,
like Google.
Right, big tech
so
media.
Think, So part of the fake news scare that we encounter today, I think there are lessons from the past in terms of thinking about it. And again, this goes back to the second of the two ways of fighting fake news that I described a little bit ago, by understanding the context in which fake news spreads. We are living today, among other things, in a period that can be characterized as one where the legacy media, traditional print and broadcast news organizations, are desperately trying to figure out how to contend with the realities of the Googles and Facebooks, which have taken over massive shares of advertising revenue, but aren't themselves in the business of producing reporting or news. So there is, I think, a striking parallel there.
I'd like to remind listeners that you're tuned to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. We're discussing Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion, the latest book out from Project Censored at Seven Stories Press. I'm speaking with the Associate Director, Andy Lee Roth, who's also co-editor with me of this volume, and we'll continue that conversation after this musical break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm Mickey Huff with Chase Palmieri. On today's program, we're talking about Project Censored's latest book out on Seven Stories Press. It's Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion. On the line, I have Associate Director and co-editor Andy Lee Roth. He's co-editor of the volume with me and also Associate Director of Project Censored. Before the break, we were talking about some of the major themes, fighting the fake news invasion and going back to both H.G. Wells and Orson Welles and the War of the Worlds. So, Andy Lee Roth, let's bring it up to the present a little bit and talk about some of the top stories. How do we go about searching for these? Of course, you're also the coordinator of our Validated Independent News and Affiliates program, working with campuses across the country.
So, for years now, Project Censored has invited college students and their faculty mentors from college and university campuses across the country and indeed around the world to help us identify and vet and publicize some of the most important but underreported independent news stories each year. This year, the top 25 list that we've produced, that top 25 list is the collective efforts of some 351 college and university students, 15 of their faculty members from 13 different college and university campuses across the United States and Canada. Those stories are initially identified and vetted for their quality, for what, if any, corporate news coverage they've received, and then summarized by the students and their faculty mentors. And ultimately, each year, we end up with a bundle of some 200 to 300 stories, most of which are published on the Project Censored website as validated independent news stories, or VINs, as we call them. And that collection of stories is then assessed by our panel of 28 international experts who serve as judges. And they vote to rank order those stories. So each year's top 25 list is indeed the result of a year-long effort that involves the judgment and critical review of literally hundreds of people. And stories that make the top 25 list have undergone no fewer than five distinct rounds of review and vetting. So although the stories that we bring forward as top 25 stories are sometimes not well known to our audience and that sometimes are even psychologically upsetting, they are stories that we feel confident deserve wider attention. So this year's list includes important but underreported independent news stories on everything from the global decline in the rule of law as basic human rights around the world diminish, to the FBI profiling so-called black identity extremists, to restrictions, new restrictions on prisoners' First Amendment rights, and the Washington Post's ban on its employees using social media to criticize sponsors. And those are just a handful of the list of this year's top 25.
The last one you mentioned, Washington Post bans employees from using social media to criticize sponsors. That's a headline right out of the propaganda model.
We have stories that people say, oh, well, that isn't really a censored story. But this one, this Washington Post ban on employees using social media to criticize the Post sponsors, is literally an underreported story about censorship. So it is a quintessential Project Censored Top 25 story.
We see also it's Mint Press News, Whitney Webb, The Hill also wrote about this. This was also in Washingtonian. It was researched by Elliot Cohen at Indian River State College in Florida. So this is, you know, kind of example of how we talk about who does the research and who does the vetting, and the student is Brian Sergel. It was covered, but these are hardly widely distributable kinds of publications, the best known of them possibly The Hill. But this is a pretty big story about media.
Yeah, and credit in this case to The Washingtonian, which is kind of a D.C. Beltway insider outlet. They're the ones who broke this story back in June of last year. And at that point, no one knew about this policy. It was not public knowledge, even though it had gone into effect almost 2 months before the Washingtonian story came out. You mentioned Mint Press News, and I think Whitney Webb had one of the most incisive analyses of this. She noted that this new policy offers, and I'm quoting here, a simple loophole to corporations that might wish to avoid criticism from the Post, as becoming a sponsor of the paper would quickly put an end to unfavorable coverage. And her analysis went on to consider, of course, that the Post has been for a while now owned by Jeff Bezos, who, of course, is the CEO of Amazon. And Amazon, of course, has a $600 million contract with the CIA for web hosting services that now serve most of the U.S. intelligence community. So when we talk about these kind of connections and what the effect might be on critical reporting, this story raises serious concerns.
Indeed, it does. And you mentioned a few of the other stories, and a couple others include the limits of negative news and the importance of constructive media. FBI paid Geek Squad employees as confidential human source informants. Model Mississippi curriculum omits civil rights movement from textbooks. A lot of different kinds of stories here in this year's top 25 list. And of course, the rest of the book covers a lot of other things. I know Project Censored, since 1976, we're known for the top 25 censored stories, and that goes out in the weeklies and so forth, and that's the way that the book has always been marketed. But, Andy, share with our listeners some of the other things that are actually in this 300-page book.
Well, we have a fantastic chapter on how freedom of expression is being handled on college campuses from Sally Gimson, Lele Faroudi, and Sean Gallagher, who is at the Index on Censorship. And in a year where the popular press has referred to battles over free speech on U.S. campuses as a, quote, war zone, as one Washington Post report likened it, Gimson, Faroudi, and Gallagher's chapter provides us crucial perspective by considering the situation, campus free speech in the United Kingdom. And their chapter is explicitly written to provide kind of a comparative perspective that, in my training as a sociologist, is always a useful way to garner new insights about aspects of an issue that we might otherwise take for granted. The comparisons highlight some of those differences. We also have, I think, a very timely chapter called Time's Up, Breaking the Barriers of Sexual Harassment in Corporate Media for You and Me Too by Julie Frechette, a longtime Project Censored collaborator. And in light of the Kavanaugh nomination and the allegations of Ford and others who are in the process of coming forward, Julie Frechette's chapter, Time's Up, is as, unfortunately, as timely as ever. We have a brief chapter by Peter Phillips, no stranger to the listeners to this program, explaining why it is in 2018 that it no longer makes any sense to talk about the corporate media as, quote, mainstream media. This is, in effect, a history of both the mainstream / corporate media in the United States and how Project Censored has, the terminology that we've used has evolved as the concentration of media has become greater and greater. And so we finally asked Peter, because you and I, Mickey, as we work with contributors to the book and as we speak in events, at events, public events, we constantly hear people comparing the alternative media to the mainstream media. And we finally just asked Peter, who, of course, was director of the project for more than a dozen years. Peter, could you just lay out the argument in a simple, brief article for why it makes no sense? I won't rehash the entire argument here, but I will just quote from one brief passage of Peter's chapter. Quote, corporate media have become a monolithic power structure that serves the interests of empire, war, and capitalism. It's clearly time to stop using the term mainstream media when corporate media is both more accurate and revealing.
Indeed, that is the case. And there are several other chapters here, including The Public and Its Problems, Fake News and the Battle for Hearts and Minds by Susan Merritt. Of course, we also have the junk food news and news abuse chapters, and we'll likely have an entire show on those in the future. And coming up later on the program, our next guest will be Dr. Steve Masick. He did the Media Democracy in Action chapter, and we'll actually have Eleanor Goldfield of ACT OUT on the program here later on. Andy Lee Roth, we're going to wrap up this segment. Your last thoughts on this year's Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion.
The book is coming out the same day as Stormy Daniels' tell-all book, Full Disclosure. Probably Stormy Daniels' book will get a lot more attention than this book, Censored 2019, does. But if we were thinking in terms of the metaphor of junk food news, I believe there's a lot more of substance to nourish interested citizens and engaged community members in Censored 2019 than they'll find in Stormy Daniels' Full Disclosure, with all due respect.
Andy Lee Roth, Associate Director of Project Censored and co-editor with me of Censored 2019, thank you so much for joining us today for a fascinating conversation about the latest Project Censored book.
Thank you. A pleasure.
Up next on the Project Censored show, we'll talk to Steve Masick about his contributions to Censored 2019, Media Democracy in Action. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, in studio with Chase Palmieri. In this segment of the program, we continue our focus on Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion. It's out now, the latest book from Project Censored at Seven Stories Press. Chris Finan, the executive director of the National Coalition Against Censorship, writes of Censored 2019. For more than 40 years, Project Censored has been our watchdog on the establishment media, casting its eye on how the information that we receive or don't receive shapes our democracy. We need it more than ever today. Well, in terms of how it's shaping our democracy, we have on the line now Dr. Steve Masick. He teaches courses in media studies and urban studies. He's the author of Urban Nightmares, The Media, The Right, and The Moral Panic Over the City, a critical analysis of media representations in American cities and the urban poor in the 1980s and 90s. His articles on Chicago's radical and alternative press have been published in Area Magazine and in the collective A Moment of Danger, Critical Studies in the History of U.S. Communication Since World War II. Steve Masick, it is an honor to have you on the Project Censored Show, not only for all of your wonderful accomplishments, but also because you graciously contributed to Censored 2019 with Andy Roth and I this year. You were the curator of the Media Democracy in Action chapter. You amassed a great collection of people that are really working to make a difference.
Thank you, Mickey, for having me on the show, and thank you for inviting me to contribute to the Project Censored Yearbook. I've been reading the Project Censored Yearbook since I think I was in graduate school, way back in the early 90s when I discovered Project Censored. So I've been a longtime fan of the yearbook, and I'm happy to finally have had an opportunity to have a hand in producing it. So thank you for inviting me.
You did really stellar work, Steve. And I want to also tell listeners that you teach at North Central College outside of Chicago. You were a gracious host. I had the great pleasure of going to Chicago for the Union Democratic Communications conference there last May, and your longtime involvement in UDC. Highly commendable. Of course, you'll also be joining us at the Media Freedom Summit 2.0.
Looking forward to that.
October 26th and 27th at College of Marin. And of course, folks can find out more at projectcensored.org. And Steve Masick will be out here with us. But Steve, tell us about the work that you did on the 2019 book.
The Project Censored Yearbook for roughly the past 15 years has featured a chapter entitled Media Democracy in Action that showcases the voices of organizations, alternative media outlets, and individuals who are fighting against censorship, disinformation, and the corporate media's enormous influence over our culture, our politics, and our media. In the past, I know the chapter has included contributions from people like Abby Martin of the Empire Files, and I know she's a frequent guest on the show, from Mint Press, which is another excellent alternative news outlet, from civil liberties groups like Defending Dissent Foundation, and others, right? This chapter has been published for the last 15 years. This year, I had an opportunity to solicit essays from a number of groups and media outlets or programs that I really admire. One of the groups that's a focus of the chapter is Uncoke My Campus.
This is chapter 4 in the book, Media Democracy in Action, and you have contributions here by Samantha Parsons on Uncoke My Campus, the American Association of University Professors, the podcast Uncivil, and we also have Jay Spagnolo and L. Aviv Newton. Project Censored Show listeners might remember Poets Reading the News that sometimes had a segment right on our program, as well as Eleanor Goldfield of Act Out. And Eleanor, in fact, will be our last guest today after you're on here, Steve Masick.
Fantastic.
So go ahead and talk to us about Uncoke My Campus.
Your listeners may be familiar with the Koch brothers. These are the billionaire brothers, Charles and David Koch, who own oil companies, among other things, and have been using their billions to influence state and federal elections to promote their extreme right-wing views and free market libertarian policy. But people really probably aren't aware that the Koch brothers also spend an enormous amount of money to try to manipulate America's universities so that they serve the same political agenda. According to Uncoke My Campus, which is an activist group, mainly student-led, although there are some faculty involved, according to Uncoke My Campus, the Koch brothers have spent close to $200 million over the past 15 years or so on programs at nearly 500 colleges and universities. They've also coordinated $100 million in donations from other donors to set up Koch-supported academic programs that are really about advancing right-wing ideas in an academic context, and also, to a lesser degree, about creating a talent pipeline of conservative intellectuals who will move out of colleges and universities into the various Koch-funded right-wing think tanks and front groups around the country. And what Uncoke My Campus has been doing is, first of all, doing research to expose the strings that are often attached to the contributions that the Koch brothers give to institutions of higher education. Usually when the Koch brothers give money to an academic department or program, and of course they prefer above all to contribute money to economics departments, they demand to have a say over what texts are taught in that department, over who gets hired, which faculty get hired using the money that they've contributed, so they can pose a kind of ideological litmus test on the hiring of faculty, which is a direct violation of the academic freedom. So this has happened at George Mason University, at Florida State University, and at a number of other universities. And faculty and students have pushed back, and it's been really largely thanks to the efforts of groups like Uncoke My Campus that they, first of all, become aware of these backroom deals that are being cut by donors like the Koch brothers and their network of right-wing millionaire allies attempting to kind of shape the nature of our university and influence the nature of scholarship and teaching on campus. But probably the most famous example was at George Mason University, where students led by Samantha Parsons, who is the author of this contribution, who was a George Mason University student, filed a lawsuit against the university and its fundraising foundation in order to obtain access to the Koch donor agreements, right, to the agreements that they had made with the Koch brothers. And, you know, George Mason is the recipient of, you know, kind of a huge amount of Charles Koch Foundation giving, totaling over $100 million. Your listeners who may have read Nancy McLean's book, Democracy in Chains, it details the degree to which the Koch focused on George Mason as the academic outpost for their extreme right-wing libertarian views, and they threw money at George Mason University to create a series of quasi-independent institutes housed in George Mason University that have as their sole purpose right-wing propaganda. Propaganda, whether it's in the field of economics, in the field of political science, or even in philosophy and the humanities. They have a humanities institute as well. Anyway, Uncoke My Campus filed a lawsuit that really blew the lid off of these agreements. And for your listeners who might be interested in buying the book, this is one reason, you know, the contribution to the chapter from Samantha Parsons of Uncoke My Campus really goes into a little bit more detail about just exactly how the Koch brothers try to manipulate universities to serve their political agenda and how students and faculty are fighting back.
So, Steve, a lot of us, especially our listeners, know about how the Koch brothers are infiltrating these college campuses. But can you speak a little bit to what the Uncoke My Campus organization is doing to actually fight back?
Their main focus is shining light and, like I said, filing these lawsuits to get access to the information, because oftentimes the Koch brothers set up, configure their funding of, say, university institutes in such a way that it's difficult for students and faculty and stakeholders at the university to find out what's actually going on. So they have brought lawsuits. They also issue reports based on their research. So they're doing a lot of in-depth research, and they're also networking, especially students at campuses around the country, providing assistance for students at various universities where the Koch brothers might be funding some activity, and providing them with logistical assistance, research assistance, so that they can organize to fight back. So it's really kind of a networking effort.
And the chapter is called Media Democracy in Action. Are there any greater trends that you're seeing as far as communities or populations or societies doing and behaving in a way that is acting as a media democracy, besides the organizations you have listed in this chapter?
There was a lot of talk a decade ago, and I know Mickey was involved in the so-called media reform movement, and that movement hasn't completely gone away. For example, in the past year, and we really did want a contribution on the issue of network neutrality and how various activist groups and various people were trying to resist the decision by the Trump administration to rescind the network neutrality policy that had been put in place by the Obama administration, which of course did happen. We did try to solicit some groups to write about that, but they were so busy fighting.
But Steve Masick, this is a chance to maybe toot your own horn, because an organization that you've long been affiliated with, that we've partnered with on occasion, UDC, remind listeners about the important work of UDC.
The Union for Democratic Communications has been around for over 30 years now, maybe even approaching 40 years, and it is an organization of academics, media producers, journalists, filmmakers, people producing alternative TV and alternative online media, and media reform activists. And it's an effort to kind of bridge the divisions between people critically studying the media and people engaged in media production. And we have partnered over the years at various points with Project Censored.
When many people think about democratizing media, I think a lot of listeners' minds might go straight to Twitter as a platform where anybody's voice can be heard, except for Alex Jones, that is. But for the most part, people can jump on Twitter and speak their minds. And in a way, it is the democratization of media. Can you tell us why that is or isn't enough? Is the job done?
I think there is a role for people who devote a substantial portion of their time to producing media, because if some of the debacles and some of the failures of journalistic coverage have demonstrated over the past few years that journalism, gathering facts, winnowing through them to try to identify the truth, and putting them together in a readable narrative that is factually based, is difficult. It isn't easy. It requires work. And so I think there's a need for people who devote their time either, exclusively, as a full-time job, or at least partially to the task, right, of reporting on what's going on around the world.
We've been speaking with Professor Steve Masick. The organization that we were talking about earlier, the Union for Democratic Communications, the website is democraticcommunications.org. So I wanted to make sure we got that in there, Steve Masick. We're out of time for this segment, but I wanted to thank you again for taking time to talk to us about media democracy in action. That's your contribution here to the new Censored book. And coming up next on the Project Censored show, we'll be speaking to one of the contributors to Chapter 4, the Media Democracy in Action chapter. It will be Eleanor Goldfield. She's returning to the Project Censored show to talk about her contribution with Act Out. So, Steve Masick, I want to thank you again for the work you do at UDC, the work you do as an independent scholar, and we're looking forward to seeing you out here in California at College Marin, October 26 and 7 for the Media Freedom Summit. Listeners can go to projectcensored.org to learn more. Steve Masick, thanks for joining us on the Project Censored show.
Thanks so much for having me on, and I look forward to seeing you later in October.
Up next on the program, we'll wrap up with Eleanor Goldfield. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff, with Chase Palmieri. Wrapping up this edition of the Project Censored Show, where we're focusing on Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion. That's the latest book by Project Censored out now on Seven Stories Press. We welcome back to the program Eleanor Goldfield. She has been on the show before and is actually a contributor to the newest Project Censored book. And she's in Chapter 4, the Media Democracy in Action chapter that was compiled by Steve Masick, who we just had on. Eleanor Goldfield is a creative activist, journalist, and poet. She's the founder and host of the show Act Out, which airs on Free Speech TV, among other places. Her articles and her show cover people and topics which corporate media either censor or misrepresent. So clearly some overlap here with what Eleanor does and what we do at Project Censored. Her spoken word performances blend visual projections and politically charged poetry. Her latest book, Paradigm Lost, blends radical verse with art from 15 dissident artists. She also was the co-founder and singer of Rooftop Revolutionaries, a political rock band. She is currently based in Washington, D.C., and her website, Art Killing Apathy. We'll learn more about that. Eleanor Goldfield, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Thanks so much for having me.
This year, we tapped you to contribute to our Media Democracy in Action chapter because we strongly believe that you exemplify what goes along with that kind of phrase and the activism and action that is behind it. So remind our listeners, what are you doing with the program Act Out?
Thank you for saying that I exemplify what you all are doing because I think it's absolutely important work. What I felt was lacking in a lot of alternative media circles was this idea of, okay, now we know what's really going on. We've gotten access to the real news outside of corporate media. Now what do we do with that information? So Act Out stems from this idea of acting on that information received. And part of that is still very much built on the foundation of getting that information out that corporate media doesn't talk about. So indeed, the censored stories, as Project Censored does a brilliant job of. So that's still a big part of what Act Out does, the weekly show that highlights those issues and also then, of course, the people working on the front lines to address those issues, primarily in grassroots and local areas. For instance, the fight against the Bayou Bridge Pipeline in Louisiana, you know, Black Lives Matter chapters around the country, the fight for reproductive rights, indigenous sovereignty. So those kind of issues on a grassroots level combined with getting people that information that corporate media won't ever touch.
You have been doing this show for some time. You also do other work as an artist, and you also have a podcast that you do?
The show Act Out also has an audio version, the podcast version, which comes out every week. But there's also another podcast that I do with the comedian activist Lee Camp. We have a show called Common Censored, and I'm not ashamed to say that your influence is felt there. So that show is freeform. So Lee and I both have these shows where we write ahead of time the stories that we're going to share. So we both read from a teleprompter words that we've already written. And I'd like to emphasize that we write them. The Common Censored podcast is very much freeform. So it's a discussion that we have kind of like this radio show where you just have people discussing topics, headlines, but also deeper sort of philosophical and psychological issues that we face on a social and political level. So that is also a podcast, Common Censored, and both Common Censored and Act Out are available on Stitcher and Spotify and iTunes and wherever you get your podcast.
Eleanor Goldfield, could you just share a couple of websites with us for our audience? Do you have a couple that you'd like to share where people can find more of your work?
The main one is artkillingapathy.com. That's my main site, and that will link to the podcast. It'll also link to articles that I've written on a wide variety of issues, articles that are pulled from the show, but also articles that I've written outside of the show, artistic events such as my spoken word and projected visuals that I perform, music events. So that's really the main hub for all of the projects and work that I do. So you can also find the show Act Out on Free Speech TV, which is available at freespeech.org/shows. And just click on Act Out.
Can you give our listeners a couple examples of some of the stories that you've been working on most recently? I know you travel around a lot. You do a lot of investigative reporting. Just to give our listeners an idea of some things that you've been doing recently.
I'm half Swedish, so I grew up partially in Sweden. And I was recently in a town in southern Sweden that has been awarded the greenest city for 2018. And so I visited to get a better idea of what some of the things that they've implemented are so that people can kind of be inspired by those stories. So that's a recent story that I've covered. And I think what's probably most inspiring about this is the idea that we can all do something. And the beauty of solidarity and working together to address issues such as they had a disgusting situation with toxic sludge in their lakes that had been used for industrial and human waste runoff for decades. And they addressed it and found a way to clean it up. And then they realized, oh, wow, we can go even further. We can use our food waste for biofuel for our cars and for our buses. and we can use waste from the timber industry to fuel electricity in our heating. So these kind of ideas that are possible for anybody anywhere to address based on their own sort of ecosystem and where they find themselves geographically. So that was a super inspiring story. Potentially less inspiring are, you know, some of the pipeline sites that I've visited personally, from Pennsylvania, the Mariner East 2 pipeline, to Louisiana, the Bayou Bridge pipeline, which is the tail end of the Dakota Access pipeline, and really horrific scenes of what the state and the state-sponsored oil companies, in this case, Energy Transfer Partners, are doing to perpetuate the oppression and extraction based on their for-profit over people and planet model. So I've been covering that. But then there's also a lot of inspiration there, too, seeing how people are creatively addressing this and not just fighting back, but building for the future. So you see people building community farms and working in solidarity to address things like public health in places that have been ravaged by the oil and gas industry. So also a lot of inspiration there. Also recently covered the issue of lead in water, including the proliferation of lead in water in the Charlotte-Mecklenburg school system where I grew up, and the CMS initiative to cover that up from parents and from teachers and from students. So these are some of the more recent stories. I'm also currently on an organizing level working directly with the Medicare for All campaign to install a national improved Medicare for All plan.
Well, Eleanor Goldfield, you are a creative activist, journalist, and poet. You've been on the Project Censored show before, and I would also like to remind listeners, not only is Eleanor Goldfield in Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion, in our Media Democracy in Action chapter, but Eleanor will be one of five women that's part of a keynote roundtable discussion at the 2018 Media Freedom Summit 2.0, Critical Media Literacy for Social Justice. That's the summit sponsored by Project Censored, ACME, The Weave, College of Marin. That's here in Northern California. That's October 26 and 7, Friday night, October 26. Eleanor Goldfield will be joined by Sarah Lazare, web editor at In These Times, Minarma Howish of Mint Press News, Nuriberas Friedman of Electronic Intifada, as well as Abby Martin of the Empire Files. And Abby Martin, of course, wrote the foreword for Censored 2019. Eleanor Goldfield, thanks so much for joining us briefly in your busy schedule on today's program showcasing Censored 2019. And we look forward to seeing you at the end of October.
Thanks so much for having me.
That was Eleanor Goldfield of ACT OUT. Again, she'll be with us at the Media Freedom Summit at the end of October. You can learn more about the Media Freedom Summit at projectcensored.org. Today's program has been dedicated to the release of Censored 2019, Fighting the Fake News Invasion. Our first guest was co-editor and associate director Andy Lee Roth, followed by Professor Steve Masick and also Eleanor Goldfield. I am Mickey Huff, the host of the program with co-host Chase Palmieri.
You've been listening to the Project Censored show, established in 2010 by Mickey Huff and Peter Phillips. Mickey Huff is executive producer and host of the program. Anthony Fest is our senior producer. And thanks to our associate producers, Dennis Murphy and Mitch Scorza. The Project Censored show airs on over 40 stations around the United States, from Maui to New York. To learn more about our work or to find any of our previous archived programs, just go to projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and be sure to subscribe to the official Project Censored show on your cell phone's podcast app. Please feel free to share your feedback about our work. And last but not least, thanks to you, our listeners, for tuning in. We'll see you next time. Bright with waves full of poison, genocide wars fought for little boys, and the weapons manufactured paid for by attacks on the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons filled with capacity citizens, and the times for the master thief to find and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Times for an out to reach all potential. If you ain't at the table, then you're probably on the menu. We got that love, lift up brothers and our sisters. The people together can overthrow the system. We got that love, lift your brothers and your sisters. The people organized can build the country.
KPFA's Fall Drive is over, and what an incredible 3 weeks of programming it was. We presented live coverage of the She the People Summit in San Francisco and carried the Kavanaugh hearings from gavel to gavel. Yes, we fell short of our goal in order to keep you informed. Always mission first. So please, go to our website at kpfa.org and donate now. Our tremendous premiums are still up, and no donation is too small. It all keeps us vigilant, as always. Thank you for your generous support.
listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.
And the time is 2 p.m. Next up.